last week, I and Pearl, we celebrated our wedding anniversary, and we were amazed seeing our baby Claire so eager to cut the cake, and she was really so happy. She wants to cut the cake, and looking at her, my mind started thinking this way. I'm a father now, and my baby is going to turn one. And truly, I'm saying I'm still not able to process that I got married itself. I still feel so young. And now, Nelson was praying for us as calling parents. The moment I heard the word, it was quite unique for me, quite different for me. Still, I'm getting used to these words. And when Claire started calling Mama and Papa, and still I'm getting used to it. So days are passing really very fast. I just came to Hyderabad in 2014, and the days pass so much, so fast. Like, you know, it's been 8 years. I came to know you, and you came to know you. We started having fellowship together, and I could not even fathom how it is, how it works. So one thing is true, that all of us can testify that the days are passing very fast. Even Uncle Sanjay Rao can say that 78 years of my life, very fast, passed very fast. You know, life is too short. That's how we feel. But I still remember, as a child, I used to wait from one summer vacation for the other summer vacation. So one summer vacation comes, once they're coming to an end, there will be some kind of disturbance in the heart. Our hearts will be very heavy, and we'll be looking forward for the next summer vacations. Children, can you relate to me? Like, and some of you children would be even waiting from one birthday to the next birthday. So my birthday is over now, still 364 days are left for my next birthday. And there are people who count the days. You know, the time is different for person to person. The perception of time is different. For children, the time looks too long. For adults, and especially for older people, they can say, I really don't know that the years are passing like days. And we people of my age can say years are passing like months. So the perception of the time is different from person to person. And the perception of the time is different from mood to mood also. If you fall in love, you know, as you started talking to your girlfriend or boyfriend, you know, the phone bill will be coming in thousands. But still you feel it's too short, right? If you are waiting for a train in the railway station, if the waiting time is just 15 minutes, it looks like an age we waited for the train, isn't it? So the perception of the time changes from mood to mood also. And not only that, the time is quite different from creature to creature. For us, the days and time is different. For animals, it is different. I really do not know what is the kind of difference, but it is very much sure, and all of you know this, that the time is different from creature to creature. But one thing is true in all of these things, that time limits us. We all feel the kind of limitation because of time, especially me. I'm feeling that every time I stand here, I'll be looking at the clock, and we'll be waiting for the council to tell me the kind of limitations we have in regard to time. All of us, we feel that. And there are so many limitations that humanity could overcome to an extent, but this one particular limitation that humanity could not overcome yet. At the same time, we all have a deepest desire. In all humans, there is a deepest desire not to be limited by time, especially me, whenever I come before the mic. So we all want to be free from the limitations that are set by the time. And that is the reason all the religions and philosophies speak about a life where we will not be limited by time, which we are calling it as eternal life. We all are looking forward for a life without, where we don't have the limitations of time. And there are people who want to live long. They tried, they did their best to save their life so that they can live for more, for long, but they could not succeed. And ultimately, the religion and especially the faith is giving us some kind of comfort in our hearts that we are going to live and we are going to overcome these limitations of time. We spoke much about time. What is this time actually? What is time? So there are a few definitions I would like to bring to your notice. Some said, time is a continued sequence of existence and events that occur in an apparently irreversible succession from the past through the present and into the future. It is the sequence of events that happened in one's life, in the life of humanity, which we are calling history, the sequence of events from past to the future. These cannot be reversed. Once happened, happened. We cannot change it. And some say, time is a measure of non-stop consistent change in our surroundings, usually from a specific viewpoint. Time is something that shows about the kind of changes that are taking place. So it is a measure of how much change that has taken place. I can really feel how time glows when I look at the special change that happened to my Madhya Pradesh. And it's so fast. The time tells me when I came in 2014, how I was and how I am now. And Aristotle, a Greek philosopher, he says, the calculable measure of motion with respect to before and afterness. This is a calculable measure about before and afterness. But whatever, if you look at all these three definitions, there are few words that highlight, that come very strongly. Number one word is, there is an event that is taking place. Event starting and event is getting over. Otherwise, a change is starting and the change is completed. And in other words, we can even take it as a motion. Motion means, we know, the movement. A movement is taking place and it is being completed. That is one. All these three things can be considered as one category. The change, an event, a motion. And the next thing we can find is, this time is closely related to all these things and they cannot be separated. Time cannot be separated from the motion. Time cannot be separated from events. Time cannot be separated from the change. If you talk about an event, what is the first word you ask? As Manava said, Praveen is going to give the details of Claire's birthday. The event is going to come. We talk about the beginning of the event if we talk about end of an event. And when we talk about the movement, we talk where we started and where we have come. When we talk about change, where we were and where, how the change has taken place. So this time, this movement, change and all these things and time are so very closely related and they cannot be separated. There cannot be a V event without beginning and end, which is denoting time. And it is an insubstantial but very essential gift that God has given to us. It is not tangible. Time, we cannot touch it and feel it, just like how we touch water, earth, and other stuff. But these are very essential to all of us. This is very essential to all of us. We cannot touch and feel it, but we know it is there, and it is always constantly chasing us, and we are always running short of time. Having said this, as Christians, it is important for us to understand the relationship between God and time also. Does God have time? Yeah? Does God have time? I could see some heads are being nodded top to bottom, up and down, some are left and right. So that is the Asian communication that tells me some are saying, yes, God has time. And some are saying, no, God doesn't have time. He is timeless. And there are philosophies who teach regarding things regarding that also. The classic philosophy, which means the philosophy which is related to 300 BC till 500 AD, this period, and even classic theology means those are the things we need to consider. So this classic philosophy and theology says God is timeless because time decides the limits of existence. Time decides the limits of existence. Once we go to symmetry on every tome, what we find? Birth, death, date, a particular date from a particular date to a particular date. That tells the existence of that particular person. So what these people say is time speaks about the limitations of existence. That is why God does not have time. God, because he is eternally existing, he should not be having time, because God cannot be limited. He is unlimited. Nothing can be infinite if it exists in time. That's what they say. Nothing can be infinite, or nothing can be eternal if it is existing in time. Just like all of us, we have birth and death on our tombs. And as some say, it is also a traditional view that says God is timeless in the sense of being outside time altogether. God is not inside the time. We humans, we creatures only are limited in time. But God is above it. If there is a circle of time and we all caught up inside that, or if a box of time is there, we all are inside, God is outside the box. He is not having any time. That is, he exists but does not exist at any point of time, and he does not experience temporal succession. Why they are saying this is because when we talk about time, there will be a temporal succession. What I meant by that is a temporal succession of past, present, and future. This is a succession. Whatever is present now, immediately it becomes past. Whatever is future, it becomes present. There is a succession in the time. So God cannot have this succession because it denotes a change. If God has to be eternal and limitless, infinite God, he should not be under the time. So he should be above the time. So God cannot come under the box of time. And they also say, they also define eternity as what exists outside time. In other words, eternity is present permanently now. Permanently now. Eternity is something, it is about time. It does not be under the inside the box. And you might have heard, for us we have past, present and future. But for God, for him everything is present only. Our past is present to him. Our present is present to him. And our future is also present to him. Have you heard this? Discussions and these perspectives, and this is very prominent and very common among the Christians. And so, God's eternity is described as a timeless existence where categories of past, present, and future just do not apply for God. So, for God, there is no past, there is no future. All that exists is present, and it is more like a presentism, a perspective that he speaks. Only reality is present. And they also say, God should be timeless because he is immutable. I'm using some big words, I know. The word immutable means person who never change. There will be no change. God never changes. Okay? That is what talking about the immutability of God. If you talk about time, past is there, present is there, future is there. There is a motion, there is a change which we discussed in the beginning. So time denotes, and these in the definitions of time we have seen one of the major word we can find there is change. So, if change is there, then God is not immutable. That is one of the fundamental characteristics of God. God is changing. That means He is growing better or worse. So, the change is, change makes God imperfect. So, God should not have any change. So He should be immutable. That's why He cannot, He cannot have past, present, and future, which always change. And we people, the people also quote the scripture, Hebrews chapter 13, verse 8, where it says, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. These are the words we hear people speak about. But these words should not be understood as immutability of God, but it is talking about the faithfulness of God. God, in relation to us, He will never change. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. This verse has to be interpreted in terms of relationship that God has with His people. And some more people say, God created time along with the creation, and then He entered in the time. So God is not under the time, God is above the time. But God created time the moment He created the worlds. So we humans, we only have time. So the time started from the day God created the world, and then He started having communion and communication with humans and started involving and interfering in human affairs, and completely through incarnation He became a human. So God created time, then He entered time. That's what they say. But overall, God is above time. This time he does not come under time. This is also one of the perspectives we hear. And some people say God has time, but His time is different from our time. Just like our time is different from the time that other creatures like dogs and other animals have. So God's time is different, your time is different. So when sometimes when we talk also, we will be using God does everything right in His time. And our time and His time are different. His time is the perfect time. And I agree with all of that. But philosophically, or as we are talking, these people are saying differently. It is not that comforting message that talking about. But God has a different sense of time altogether. And we have a different sense of time. So these are the perspectives available in the world, and very common among the Christians and among the philosophers and in various philosophies. Of course, we are in a culture where another perspective of time is very prominent, that is, time is cyclical. And just like the seasons, summer comes, winter comes, and summer, monsoon, winter comes, the same way the cycle will be going on. So there are various perspectives on this also, but I'm not going to focus on that now. But my focus is Trinitarian thinking about timing. Trinitarian thinking about timing. First thing is, time cannot affect God as it limits us. God is infinite and eternal, and God cannot be affected by time as we are being affected. And our God is a God of time. He is not a timeless God. When we look at the doctrine of Trinity, a Christian understanding of God, we understand our God is a God of time. So where is the first word we can find about time? That is in Genesis chapter 1 verse 1, where it is written, in the beginning God created heavens and the earth. What is the beginning? Beginning is talking about a time. Oh, or sometimes you may say that this is the beginning of the world, the creation. So it is talking about the time of the creation, but not for God. Oh, then let's come back to New Testament, where in John chapter 1 verse 1 it is written, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. What is this beginning? Is it the beginning of the creation? Obviously not. We can clearly understand it is a beginning in God Himself. It is talking about a time that God has. So one thing we understand very clearly here, that is, God is a God of time. He has a time. Kindly don't misunderstand. I'm not saying God has a beginning and he is going to have an end. I said he has a time. That's all. We'll discuss more about it as we are moving forward. And also in Galatians chapter 4 verse 4, we find that in due time, God sent his son into this world. So here also we understand our God is the God of time. He is not a timeless God. Okay? And why he cannot be a timeless God? Is it because, as we discussed in the beginning, a motion, a change, or a movement cannot be separated from time. Right? Do you agree with that? A motion and a change cannot be separated with time. What is the formula for work done? You can think about your studies, which you studied in 10th or 11th. What is work done? Work done equal to F into S, force into displacement. What is force? What is force? Force is displacement, into acceleration. F equal to ma, mass into acceleration. Okay? What is acceleration? Acceleration is the rate of speed or rate of displacement or rate of velocity. D by dx of v equal to acceleration. So I'm sorry for using that school terminology language and all. Okay, the rate of change of velocity is acceleration. What is velocity again? Comes back to rate of change of displacement. Okay? Rate of displacement is velocity. Rate of velocity is acceleration. F into F force equal to mass into acceleration. And then work done equal to F into S, force into displacement again. So there are two components of time here. So time cannot be separated from motion. If time is zero, how can I take the next step? If I took the next step, means there should be a time that passed where I put from my step from here to the next place. And a movement cannot exist without time. But the God we find in the Bible is a God of fellowship. He is Trinity. He is Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. He is called the God of fellowship. Okay, there is a fellowship in between Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. And he is not a static God who just got stuck and frozen. He could not move anything. But our God is a God full of activity within himself. He is not monotheistic God. Like that's a theological term used for one person, one God. And who has nothing to do anything. He has nothing. There is nothing to express or to do anything there. So our God is a God full of activity and full of movement. And this movement cannot take place without time. And our God is a God where his fellowship and continuously Father, Son and the Holy Spirit, they were exchanging love. They were exchanging joy. And they were exchanging mutual respect and glory. So they were loving each other. That is the God we find in the Bible. Jesus says, Father loves with the love that he loved Jesus from the foundations of the world. And Jesus says, give me the glory that you have given me from the foundation of the world. So God is a God where a full activity is there. He is a dynamic God. So this dynamic God cannot exist without time. The movement in God himself requires time. So what even, let me take next step and say, the movement within God himself creates time. The movement and time cannot be separated, and they are interdependent, and movement creates time, and time creates an opportunity for the movement to take place. So our God is a Trinity, he is a fellowship, he is a continuous movement, and there is mutual exchange of love, and from eternity to eternity he remains the same. So the time facilitates or creates an opportunity for the movements and exchange and fellowship. That is the reason God should have time. The God we find in the Bible will has time because He is a God of the moment. And the moment in God creates opportunity for time to exist. It is not that time is causing the moment. It is the moment within God Himself that is creating an opportunity for time to exist. And this time is insubstantial. This is not a material thing or anything to exist, to talk about existence. Okay? What is time? Basically, coming to once back, coming to this question, time is can be divided into past, present, and future. Past is something which is no more a reality. Over. Whatever happened in the past, it's over. And future is which is not yet a reality. What is the only reality? Can I hear some answers? Oh, present. Present is the only reality, right? But let me tell you, the present also is not the only reality. It is the journey from which is no more a reality to which is not yet a reality. It's over. The moment is over. The moment is over. In its very journey from past to future, the time is very insubstantial. It does not have a substance in itself. That is the reason time cannot be anything that can be eternal and substantial like God. God alone is eternal and substantial, and the movement in God creates opportunity for time to exist. Now, since the time is within God, time cannot limit God. Time is not limiting God, but it will extend as God continues His activity from fellowship within Himself to fellowship with us. The time will be becoming more and more as much as God, the fellowship and activity in God is happening. As long as the activity in the Father, in between Father, Son and the Holy Spirit continues, time will be growing. And He continued the same by extending that fellowship with us. So the time is growing again. So, but time is not above God, but time is within Himself. And as much as the activity takes place, the time will be growing. And that's why in Revelation chapter 21, verse 5 to 6, God says, "He who was seated on the throne said, 'I am making everything new.'" What did He make new? Everything. So look at the word new. New itself talks again about time. And it talks about change. So here the change and the time, these are not going to affect God. This change is not affecting God. Because mutually that's exchanging their love. In that there is no change. And we read the word from Hebrews. Yesterday, today and forever, Jesus never changed. That is talking about relationship. And when we talk about immutability of God, God never changes God never changes as far being Father, Son and the Holy Spirit. That's why He is immutable. Forever He is Father, Son and the Holy Spirit. He is not going to become grandfather anymore. And like how we are growing and becoming grandfather. So there won't be any change in God. There won't be any strife. There won't be any problem within God. So He will be a perfect love always within Himself. So He never changes. That is what talking about immutability. So He is making everything new. The newness is not going to affect God. Because immutability is talking about His very nature. And He is going to adopt we are going to see how God is going to facilitate this change and temporality also. So God made everything new and He said that I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. If time is above God, He cannot be the beginning and the end. He will be limited to time. If He is outside the time, these words don't make any sense to say that He is the beginning and He is the end. And He says, I am the beginning and I am the end. I am the Alpha and I am the Omega, which tells the time is within Himself. It is not above Him. It becomes an attribute of God. Just like holiness, righteousness that we have, the time becomes a quality of God because He is a complete fellowship within Himself. He does not transcend time, but time exists within Himself. And the activity of exchange does not change God, to affect immutability of God, as I mentioned, He remains as Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, and nothing is going to affect that. So, you may say that, you know, what about when God takes change and these things, they are affecting His other qualities like perfection, immutability, and His sovereignty and all. One thing let me remind you, and which will humble us mostly as we are thinking about God. God is sovereign, but He is not slave to His sovereignty. God is immutable, means He never changes. He is not slave to His immutability. God is perfect, but He is not slave to this something called perfectness. He is God, and He is not slave to His any of His attributes. So sometimes we think, oh, this is His quality, so He has to be like that. No, He doesn't have to be like that only, but He does that. And there are certain other things called nature, which we are calling essence, which talks about God is Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. God is holy. God is love. That is the very essence of God, and which can never be changed, in that God is completely immutable, perfect, and never changes. So, God is not slave to any of His attribute, but His nature and who He is never changed. And through Jesus' incarnation, temporal and eternal aspects of existence were brought together. The moment we get past, present, and future, it brings us a sense of temporal and eternal. We all are temporal beings. We all have a beginning. We all have an end. We all have a limitation of time and all. I'm also very much comfortable to believe that things are very temporal. I'm looking at my tummy and I can say, oh, it's also going to be temporary. Okay, it's not going to be permanent forever. So there is a hope that all of us we have in temporality, of course. But many a times we think God is eternal. Temporality cannot affect God. But let me tell you, in incarnation, Jesus came as a man and He was a boy. Did He remain as a boy? Advent is coming, we celebrate His birth. Did He remain as a boy? No. He underwent the change. He became a young man. He died. He rose again from the dead. What is this? All these things are change. God, He was not having a body before. He took a human flesh like you and me. The Word became flesh. That is, the event took place in the time. And that is a change the eternal God underwent. He took a change. And He became a human. He grew. So God accepted, and in fact He embraced the temporality as Jesus, through the incarnation of Jesus Christ. And He remained as eternal because Jesus is 100% God and 100% man. That is another aspect of doctrine of Trinity. As I said, my message is completely focusing Trinitarian perspective. How do we look at this? So, because of doctrine of Trinity, we can clearly see that God embraced the change, in which the change could not affect God. He remained as God, as Jesus being 100% God and 100% man. And through the incarnation, God redeemed us from the limitations of time. So now, because of the incarnation, we all are temporal. Now we don't need to think about only end of our life, but we all have the hope for eternity. We all are looking forward for eternal life. And this eternal life also is not just connected to time only, but this eternal life is 100% completely connected to Jesus. That's and to our God, triune God. That's what we find in John chapter 17, verse 3, where it says, "This is the eternal life, that they may know you." Knowing God is eternal life, because all time and eternity exist within Him. These things are not above or outside God. All these things are within God, within the movement between the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. And one example I would like to bring before you, that is what the scripture we read from Exodus chapter 3, verse 13 to 17. Where Moses comes to the burning bush and he has an interaction, and Moses asks God, "What is your name?" God tells, we can find it in Exodus chapter 3, verse 14. God said to Moses, "I am who I am. If you have Bibles, go and check in your Bibles where it is written, I am who I am. There will be a footnote, small letter on above or below the words. In Telugu Bibles, it will be written in the, below everything. Footnotes will be there. You will find the better translation of that verse is, I will be who I will be. It is written, I am who I am. The better translation can be, I will be who I will be. And then this is what you ought to say to the Israelites. I am has sent you. There again, I am, the word we find. Here we find, I am who I am. Then here we next in verse 15, we find, I am. This I am is not the same that I am. The Hebrew word used are different. So this is not talking about that God. So the translation of that word is, I will be who I will be. Then God said, go and tell, I am has sent you. And then verse 15 is quite interesting, where it says, God also said to Moses, say to the Israelites, the Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, which is God of their fathers, has sent me to you. Look at these words. Who is this God? When he said, I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, he is telling them, I am God of your past. I am the God of your fathers. I am the God of your past, who was with you in your past, who held you in your past and brought you all this way in your past. And I am your Lord now. And then he says, this is my name forever. He says, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob is going to be my name forever. Go and bring, gather this generation and talk to them about the redemption that he is going to do. So look at the word Yahweh. I will be who I will be. So when God came to Moses, he is saying, I am the God of your past, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and I am with you now. You will know me by what I am going to do. That is what it means to say Yahweh. I will be who I will be. I am going to bring you out of the land of Egypt, and you are going to know me through that. That is why, if you remember, Exodus chapter 20, verse 2 to 3, where the Ten Commandments are written, how does the first commandment start? It starts saying, I am the Lord who brought you out of the land of Egypt, and you shall not have any other God before me. He is introducing himself, God of your future. What he is going to do in your future. He is God of the past, and he is in telling God of the future. So, and then ultimately he said, he is the God of people. And that is his name. That's what his name is going to be. And he is the God of the past, present, and future. He is our God, like the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And one more verse we'll find everywhere in the Bible. I realize the temporality of life now. I'm running short of time, so I'll finish my last slide. I shall be their God, and they shall be my people. Have you read these words in the Bible? It is written 11 times. 11 times this verse is written. And every time it is written after God saying what he is going to do in the life, in the future of these people. I am going to do in your life this, and I will be your God, you shall be my people. He is the God of a future. That's what we understand here. We find the same in Jeremiah 24:7, Jeremiah 31, 33, 32, chapter 32, 36 to 38, Ezekiel chapter 11, verse 20, and chapter 37, verse 27, Zechariah chapter 8, verse 8, 2 Corinthians 6, 16, Hebrews chapter 8, verse 10. All these places God tells, I am going to do something in your life by which you shall know me, and I shall be your God, and you shall be my people. He's the God of our future. He's the God of your future and my future. We may be scared about our future, but let me tell you, he is reminding us that he is the God of our future, and he is the God who works in our future. That is the comforting message he is giving to us. That is the message he has given to the children of Israel when God met Moses, or in fact when Moses met God. He said, I will be Yahweh. Yahweh means he is the God of your past, Yahweh means he's the God of your present. Yahweh means he's the God of your future. Not just a God who will be in these three times, but a God who worked in the past, in the, as he worked in the life of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. A God who works in the present, and as he is working in our lives now. A God who works in the future, as he promised and worked in the lives of children of Israel, by which the first commandment starts, I am the God who brought you out of the land of Egypt. And after that only everything. And you shall not have any other gods. All the commandments, all the lives of Israelites we can find. He's the God who works in the future, who promises about his work in the future. And he says, I will be your God, and I will be their God, and they shall be our people. So in conclusion, I would like to say, our God is a God of past. Our God is a God of past, who remembers and upholds our past, just as he always remembered Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And he's a God of our present, who came to us and who will be with us. And he is the God of our future, who promises and tells he has plans for us to prosper us, not to destroy us, and he is going to work in our future. And then we shall know that he is our God and we shall be his people. He is the God of people who are limited by time, who steps in time, and who redeems us from time. Okay, and our God, he has time, and because he has time, his very nature, he has time, and he steps into our time, redeems us out of our time. So, in conclusion, I would like to say, leave you with these words. Ecclesiastes chapter 3 verse 10 says, he has made everything beautiful in its time. Also, he has put eternity in their hearts, except that no one can find out the work of God does from the beginning to end. He does everything beautiful. He's a God of your past, present, and future. He worked, he's working, and this is the hope he gives. He continuously works, by which we shall know him. Thank you.